Hi everyone. In this lecture we're going to look at how to find the power series representation of an arbitrary function f. We're going to give a name to this power series representation. It's going to be called the Taylor series, but we'll get to that in a few moments. But for right now, let's just start with the motivating problem. Suppose I have a function f and I know it has a power series representation. So it's got a representation as this power series, some coefficients x minus a to the power of n. So this is a power series centered at a. How do we find these coefficients c sub n? Can we express the coefficient c sub n in terms of the function f? Can we express these c sub n's in terms of the function f? So that's what we'd like to do. So let's jot down what this series representation is in sort of expanded form. It's c naught plus c1 x minus a plus c2 x minus a squared plus c3 x minus a cubed, and I'll just write down one more so that when we start doing some work we can potentially see a pattern happening. Okay, so dot dot dot. So this pattern continues. Now, what can I do here? Well, I know that this power series on the right represents the function for x values within the radius of convergent of that center point A. So in particular, what it means is that if I plug in a for the value of x, so I evaluate the left-hand side at a, then that will be equal to evaluating the right-hand side at a. So I pop a into the right-hand side. The thing to notice, though, that if I pop a into the right-hand side, everything vanishes except for the very first term, because all these x minus a's will be zero. So let me just indicate that we get a whole bunch of zeros, but the first term still survives. So what that means is that the first term, the thing we're trying to actually find, we're trying to find these c values, is f of a. So that's great, because now we know exactly what the first coefficient has to be in this series expansion. Okay, so we still have infinitely many more to find, but the point is that we are able to pick off one. How can we pick off the next one? Well, the thing to observe here is that if I differentiate the function and differentiate its power series representation, I can differentiate that term by term, and I get that derivative of c0 is 0, derivative of c1 times x minus a is just c1, plus 2c2 x minus a, that's the derivative of the next one. The derivative of the term involving the cube is 3c3 x minus a squared plus 4c4 x minus a cubed plus, and that pattern continues. Now, much like the previous case, I can evaluate everything at a. So f prime at a is what the left-hand side is equal to. If I evaluate the right-hand side at a, I get a whole bunch of stuff going away except for the term c1, which survives. And so that means that c1 is f prime at a. Now, at this stage, you may think, oh, I can see the pattern. It looks like the ith coefficient is just the ith derivative at a. Well, not quite. The next case is going to show us that things are a little bit more subtle than that. So we proceed just as we did above. We take the next derivative, f prime, f double prime of x is equal to 2c2 plus 3 times 2c3 x minus a squared. Well, that's differentiated, so that becomes just a power of 1, plus 4 times 3c4 x minus a squared plus dot dot dot. And we evaluate at a again. So f double prime of a is what the left-hand side is. The right-hand side, plugging a in, everything goes away except for the first term. And so that means that c2 is equal to f double prime of a divided by 2. Okay, so the pattern didn't quite continue that we may have thought was the pattern looking at the first two terms. But we still get this pattern that the value of the coefficient c sub I seems to depend on the ith derivative. So let's do one more, see if we can spot more of what the pattern is. So f triple prime of x, the third derivative. So 2c2 vanishes, we get 3 times 2 times 1, because the exponent of 1 comes down, that's in front of the C3, plus 4 times 3 times 2 is in front of the C4, x minus a plus dot dot dot. And so f triple prime of a is equal to 3 times 2 times 1, C3, which means that C3 is f triple prime of a over 3 times 2 times 1. Okay, now a pattern seems to be emerging. Where did the 3 times 2 times 1 come from? That was the coefficient of the C3. So that this stuff here came from these numbers, which came from these numbers, which came from these numbers and the 1 that was sitting here, which came from this number and the exponent 2, which came from this number. So every time we take a derivative, the power comes down and we take one away from it. So when we've taken enough derivatives so that that power is completely depleted, what we have is that the 3 had come down, a 2 had come down, and a 1 had come down, and we'd multiplied them all together. And that is a factorial. So this is f triple prime of a over 3 factorial. But that pattern is exactly the pattern we were observing here. There is actually, or we can think of it as f double prime of a over 2 factorial, just 2 times 1. What about this one? Well, we can think of that as f prime of a over 1 factorial. And in order to extend this pattern to the first case, just to make everything neat and tidy, we could call the original function the zeroth derivative at a. We'll just call it that. It's the zeroth derivative. We haven't taken any derivatives, so we're staring at the original function. And the denominator, well, we'll define 0 factorial to be 1 so that we get this nice pattern. So the zeroth coefficient is the zeroth derivative over 0 factorial. The first coefficient is the first derivative over 1 factorial. Second derivative is, or the second coefficient, C sub 2, is second derivative over 2 factorial. C sub 3 is third derivative over 3 factorial. And so what we see here is that in general, if we keep going, we'll get that the nth coefficient is the nth derivative at a over n factorial. So that's the value of that coefficient. So what does this mean? It means that if you have a power series representation of a function, we know exactly what the coefficients have to be. They have to be the nth derivative of the function at the point you've taken the power series expansion at, so that was a in this case, over n factorial. So we've just now proven this theorem, that the power series representation is unique. If f has a power series representation, that is, we can write it in this form, then we know immediately that those coefficients have to be the nth derivative over n factorial. Okay, and we've made this convention to make that pattern hold for n equals 0 as well. So we've made sense of what we mean by 0 factorial, that's just going to be 1. And we've made sense of what we mean by the zeroth derivative, that's just the function value. So we've made sense of these two ideas, so now C0 makes sense to plug into, or n sub 0 makes sense to plug into this formula. So we've got a nice compact form for all of these coefficients. So here is the power series expansion written out. This is what we call the Taylor series of the function at a. So this power series representation for the function centered at a is what we call the Taylor series. In the particular case when we center at a equals 0, when we're focused on constructing this representation centered at 0, we call that the Maclaurin series. So the Maclaurin series is just a Taylor series where you've centered it at 0. So let's have a look at computing Maclaurin series. Remember, these are just Taylor series where the point we're centering at is 0. Okay, so let's look at A. F of x equals e to the x. Now, what do we need to do to construct the Taylor series, or the Maclaurin series in this case? We need to know those coefficients. That's the only thing we have to do. We have to work out these coefficients. That's it. Once we know these coefficients, then we just write down the series expansion. So our goal is to find those coefficients. That involves knowing the ith derivative. So we're going to have to take a whole string of derivatives. F prime of x, well, that's just e to the x. F double prime of x, that's just, again, e to the x, because the derivative of e to the x is itself. Triple prime of x, e to the x, and we continue on. So we need to know all these derivatives. Well, we don't actually need to know the entire derivative in general. We just need to know the derivative at the point we're taking the expansion at. And that is at 0. This is when a equals 0. So that's the thing we want to, or that's the value we want to plug into all of these functions and their derivatives. So this is e to the 0, which is 1. F prime of 0, well, that's e to the 0, which is 1. And so you can see the pattern here that any derivative you take, you're always going to get the value of 1. So what that means, in general, the nth derivative at 0 is 1. So what's the Maclaurin series then? The Maclaurin series, well, we need to know the coefficients. The coefficients are going to be the nth derivative over n factorial. We've just worked out the nth derivative is always 1. So the coefficients are 1 over n factorial. So the series is then f, the nth derivative of f over n factorial, times x. And here, again, we're centered at a equals 0, so it's just x to the n. So this is the sum, and this goes from n equals 0 to infinity. So this is the sum from n equals 0 to infinity of x to the n over n factorial. So there is the Maclaurin series for the exponential function e to the x. So again, notice what we did. In order to find the Maclaurin series, we just needed to know the nth derivative at the point we're taking the expansion about. In this case, it was 0. So we need to work out all of these values and come up with that general formula. Once we know these values, then we work out the nth coefficient and therefore write down the power series expansion centered at a equals 0. Let's look at the next one. F of x equals cosine of x. Again, we're going to need to know all these derivatives. So f prime of x is negative sine of x. F double prime of x is negative cosine of x. F triple prime of x is sine of x. F, the fourth derivative at x, is back to cos of x. So we've gone through a pattern here. We started with cosine, went negative cosine, and back to cosine again. And so we get this pattern that repeats. So this repeats. Now, what do we have for the values at 0 then? Well, f of 0 is cos of 0, which is 1. F prime at 0 is sine of negative sine of 0, which is just 0. F double prime of 0 is negative cos of 0, which is negative 1. F triple prime at 0 is sine of 0, which is 0. And f fourth derivative at 0 is 1. And that pattern has to continue. So here's our pattern. It goes 1, 0, negative 1, 0. And so this pattern repeats. So what's our Maclaurin series then? Well, it's going to be the nth derivative at 0 over n factorial x to the n. We can write out the first few terms just to see what's going on. So it's the function value at 0 is 1, so this is 1 over 0 factorial, so that's just 1. X to the 0, remember this starts at 0, 0 to infinity. So this is 1, and then it is 0 is the next term, and then minus 1. So that's, maybe I'll write it this way. Minus 1 over 2 factorial x squared, and then plus 1 over 4 factorial x to the fourth, and then plus negative 1 over 6 factorial x to the sixth, plus dot, dot, dot. So that's that pattern. It goes 1, there's no x term because that had the 0 as the coefficient, so it went 1, 0, negative 1, 0, 1, 0, negative 1, 0, and it keeps going. So we can try to write this in a nice compact form. So this goes from n equals 0 to infinity. Notice the only powers of x that survived were the even powers. So I can write this as x to the 2n. Now for every one of those even powers that survived, we had corresponding factorial on the bottom. It was the top that was changing sign, and it alternated. It went positive, negative, positive, negative. So when we start at 0, we wanted a positive term. And then when n was 1, we wanted a negative term. So what I've done is I've just written a nice compact form. Notice I had to have the 2n up here to just make sure that only the even powers survived. So there's a nice compact form for the Maclaurin series expansion for cosine of x. And here it is, the first few terms just written out so you can see what the pattern essentially entails. So that's our technique for working out Taylor series. It all boils down to working out the coefficient c sub n, and that involves knowing the nth derivative at the point you're setting about, dividing by n factorial.